Hi there, great to keep you company. My name is Charl, model, singer, speaker, and just a general lover of life.
Hi, I'm Nicole and I've just finished my trek. I also do modeling and I hope to have a great year with you on J&Co.
Kingdom is the name, entertainment is the game. I'm a DJ, presenter, and a student, and I give the go to J&Co.
Oh yes, that's not all. There's another member in our company.
His name is Brandon, and you never know when you might see him.
And sometimes you might not even recognize him. You never know.
And now, some more of what we have for you.
We are here to entertain,
enlighten,
and even educate you.
Yeah, we'll also have some music,
local and international,
fashion and fun events.
We're also going to get to meet a lot of interesting people.
We'll even travel back in time to meet characters you all know.
And we'll keep you updated on what's happening around the country.
But first, Charl gets to keep company with someone who's got a lot of soul.
Cross section.
Hey, isn't that your... That's Jonah. Jonah! Jonah!
Jonah.
Yeah. Jonah. How are you doing?
Well, let's just say I've been having a whale of a time.
Aren't you just a killer? It's not funny.
Sorry.
Anyway, as you can see, our guest in the studio today is Jonah.
Jonah.
How did you get here?
Well, let's just say that I didn't agree with the veiled stomach, okay.
No, I don't think you're telling us the whole story, come sir. Dry up. Get yourself dried up.
Thank you. Well, it all started when God told me to go to Nineveh to tell the city that he was going to curse it.
And?
Well, I was afraid that God would not come through with his curse. So I left and I went to Spain. You know Spain? Olé! Okay.
No. Well, while you were on the ship, apparently God sent a storm and you gave yourself up. Why?
No, I didn't just give myself up. You see, God works in very strange ways. Imagine this. We're on a ship with 200 men. We have to draw straws. Draw straws.
Yeah.
And I get to draw the short one, and I have to explain my situation to the rest of the sailors.
Oh, so they threw you overboard,
yes.
And a great fish swallowed you, and the storm ended.
And as far as I know, those sailors turned from their gods to the one and only true God, Christ.
Well, that's... Jonah, how long were you inside the fish's inside?
3 days.
3 days is a long time for a person to stay inside the belly of a fish. Now, what did you do? What did you do inside?
I prayed.
And?
I prayed some more.
So all you did was pray?
Yes.
Nothing wrong with that, is
there? Well, so would you if you smelled the inside of that veil. You know, I have never prayed for forgiveness and mercy like I did when I was inside the veils. Inside.
Now that you're on dry land,
yes.
Where to now?
None of your business.
None of my business.
Business.
Business, yeah.
In Nineveh.
Business in Nineveh. Sorry.
Anyway, I thought that's great.
Thank you for being here, and good luck with your business in Nineveh.
Business in Nineveh. Yeah. And when I'm finished, I'm going to do a little fishing. I'm going to catch me a big fish, if you know what I mean.
You know, some people just never learn. Thank goodness, God is always ready to forgive us, no matter what we do. So remember that next time you do something wrong. You know, I might even try my hand at some fishing. Well, see you later, Will. Don't worry. Well, see you later.
J&Co, go, yeah!
Well, we promised you fun fashion here on Jane Company, so here we go. First up, an original Go Mini in orange. Keep it cool and lean in green. And then out of Africa in our studio with khaki and white. Great fashion for fun in the sun. What about shorts and a yummy yellow waistcoat? To finish this cool collection from Graph Trading, be daring in dungarees. And if the occasion calls for it, you can go smart. It can be fun. To start off, a lovely selection of leather tops. Go black and white in leather and lace. And denim and leather look great together. You're sure to get a reaction in red. And a must for every wardrobe, the little black number.
The local music industry is growing and lots of new stars are emerging. And with us here in J&Co Company, we have one of them. I'd like to introduce to you Veronique. Hi, Veronique.
Hi there, Kingdom.
Thank you for taking time off to be with us.
Sure.
Great. Now, first question for you. Where do you come from?
I come from Cape Town, although I have been staying in Durban since March of 95.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Very interesting. Tell me, you've just recorded your first album.
Mm-hmm.
How did it all happen for you?
Okay, around July 94, I was shown the Joy magazine and there was an article in there called the Sarepta Talent Search.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And I entered that with a lot of persuasion from a friend of mine and sent in my demo and my tape and photograph, and it was there, I won.
Okay, and apparently over 300 entries were submitted.
That's right.
Very interesting, so you must be good.
I hope so.
Great stuff. And who writes your music?
Okay, majority of the stuff I write, but then I do have South African artists or writers writing for me, and I also have an international writer.
Yeah, on that same score, apparently Rob Fraser, a well-known writer and gospel artist, wrote two songs which are featured in your album.
Yeah.
How did that come to pass?
Okay, well, Rob Fraser is one of the artists that is under the label for Sarepta.
Okay.
And he and his wife, Carol, wrote a couple of songs that weren't really his style of music. And he submitted them to Sarepta as, you know, choices for their artists.
Okay.
And so Nerdin, Anton and myself sat down in a meeting one day and went through a whole lot of them. And there were two that were really beautiful with the lyric, you know, content was really good. And we chose those two. It was really lovely.
Very interesting. You also mentioned to me that you write your own music. What kind of music do you write?
Well, it depends on what kind of day I'm having.
Uh-huh.
If I have, if some kind of inspiration hits me, I could write a really inspirational ballad.
Uh-huh.
Or if I'm having a really stupid, fun-filled day, then I could write a dance, techno-type, funky song. I don't know.
In fact, on that same score, what kind of music do you like?
I love anything that will make me move. I love to dance, and I love techno. On the other hand, I love Christian death metal. And on the other hand, I love opera.
So what you're saying to me is you've got a versatile listening to music, right?
Yes, I do, as long as I enjoy it.
Yeah, that's good.
Yeah.
Talk about that. What influences have you experienced in your life?
Okay, musically?
In general?
Okay, I would say Mariah Carey would be my musical influence. I love her, I respect her, I think she's great. I'd say Mariah Carey.
Who do you admire in the contemporary Christian music?
Okay. I would say that I really admire Stephen Curtis Chapman. He's one of my faves, along with Amy Grant. I just feel that their love for God, although they've been established in their ministry for some time, It's their love for God has never changed, you know, and they've been in His Word and in Him for such a long time that I really admire them.
Okay, let's talk about your vision. What dream do you have for your life?
My dream would really be to be able to reach young people through my music and to just reassure them. It would just be a simple reassurance that there is hope out there and there is satisfaction and fulfillment and excitement that can be found out there, and it can be found in Jesus.
Way to go, way to go.
Now, before Veronique sings us to heaven,
we want to remind you to join us again, same time next week.
Channel 1, 6 p.m. every Sunday.
Take care now.
Bye-bye then.
Peace.
I'm not afraid to
Hi there. It's really great to keep you company once again.
And this week, the Bible comes alive.
On the screen and in the studio.
Where Kingdom gets to meet two guys who are a lot of fun.
But they are serious about God.
And this is the Book of Acts.
Thank you for keeping company with us right here on J&Co Company. We have a privilege of interviewing these two gentlemen here. And first we have Bruce, the gentleman who played the character of Jesus in the visual Bible, as well as Richard, the guy who directed the visual Bible. Gentlemen, thank you for taking time off and being with us right here on J&Co Company.
Thank you. It's good to be here.
Yeah, Bruce, thank you, man, for coming over.
It's a pleasure. It's a thrill.
Yeah, excellent. Starting from you, or with you, Rana. Where do you come from in the States, Bruce?
Los Angeles. Born and raised about an hour south of Los Angeles, California.
Uh-huh.
And I live there to this day, a stone's throw from Disney Studios.
Wow. Oh, really?
Yeah.
He's a real Hollywood man.
Tell me about it. Oh, okay. It's written all over his flesh.
Yeah. Movie.
Tell me about it. And are you an actor on a full-time basis?
I hope so, as much as I can. You know, acting's a funny, funny thing. I think people out here get a false impression that we all drive around in convertibles and palm trees and beautiful girls and slick-looking guys and everybody's got a lot of money, but it's not like that. The unemployment level is outrageous. It's a struggle to find work, and I've been an actor for about 13 years now, professionally.
Full-time?
Yeah, full-time.
Oh. Very interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah. Richard, coming back to you now. You are involved in the movies as well, but now in what capacity?
I started directing about 15 years ago. When I was 28 years old,
wow.
I got the opportunity to do a thing for SABC called Favester, and from then on it's just been movies
Sky
and television
limit.
Stuff. Yeah,
I absolutely.
Did a few films, a couple of local things, three, and some international films, and then we started the Visual Bible, which I think was for me a wonderful thing because
sure.
at that stage I was a Christian and I wanted to do it and I wanted to get involved in it.
Absolutely.
And with Matthew I met Bruce Marciano and that was a really good thing too.
Yeah.
And we share the vision, you know, we really want to, we believe that it's a new, it's, you know, instead of the old printing press, we're into the new modern way of spreading the gospel, and that's through the video camera.
Yeah, absolutely.
Now, a man crippled from birth was being carried to the temple gate called Beautiful, where he was put every day to beg from those going into the temple courts. When he saw Peter and John about to enter, he asked them for money. Peter looked straight at him, as did John. Then Peter said,
"Look at us."
So the man gave them his attention, expecting to get something from them. Then Peter said,
"Silver or gold I do not have, but what I have I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk."
Taking him by the right hand, he helped him up. And instantly the man's feet and ankles became strong. He jumped to his feet and began to walk. Temple courts, walking and jumping and praising God. When all the people saw him walking and praising God, they recognized him as the same man who used to sit begging at the temple gate called Beautiful, and they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to him.
I'd like you to actually explain to me, how did it all come about?
The visual Bible thing?
Yes.
The vision was held by some businessmen in Cape Town, and they wondered whether one could put it together. We spoke about you know, doing a low budget thing that could be a vehicle for the word for word, because that was the point of the whole thing, to do it word for word.
So the conception was here in South Africa?
Yes, absolutely. Well, there was a concept of it in New Zealand before, but that didn't work. And then
right.
it kind of drifted over the seas to South Africa. And the Lord's favor that just afforded us the opportunity to do it. We worked on a very small budget with Matthew. We did it for 2.6, 2.8 million rand.
That's still a lot.
It's a lot of money, but so I mean, in terms of movies, it's nothing, you know, it's really nothing.
Now,
and, that started it, and I believe that's a cornerstone for a really big building that's being built. Mm.
Okay,
and that is a visual Bible, word for word, that will be made. And we have interest in films and things as well, you know, to make movies on the life of Jesus, the life of Paul. We want to make a movie on the life of Esther. I think it would be wonderful.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. The sky's the limit.
She can play Esther. Where's Nicole?
Nicole will be coming up soon. When?
How come Nicole's not interviewed?
I want to
be interviewed by Nicole.
Here we go. I mean, they want Nicole. What can we say? Yeah. Well, Nicole is not available. I'm available. Tough luck, guys. Tough luck. Let's settle for this one. Definitely. Now, I can imagine that it must have been a grueling session to find that classical, typical face of a typical Jesus. You know what I'm saying?
Like this?
Yeah.
I'm Jesus.
But I tell you, the most amazing thing, I must tell you this, just on a point of being serious about how God works in things, you know, that when Bruce walked through the door, he was the last meeting that I had in the States. He was the last meeting of all the meetings I had, from South African auditions to London auditions to American auditions, New York and LA. And he was the last guy to walk through the door. This is how God works, I tell you.
Wow.
The Lord is amazing.
Mm.
He walked through the door, smiled like this. He says, is this where I read for Jesus? He sat down, or he actually had to walk out, and then I had to invite him in again, offered him coffee. And I asked the Lord when I said to him I liked what he did, before I told him that he has the part, I went to before the Lord and I asked the Lord, but why, Father? He has a little mark here.
Oh,
and
man.
You know, he's, you know, I look at the
impurity. He's my best friend here.
He's not
with you?
He's not without spot, wrinkle, or blemish. You know what I mean? And the Lord said to me something that'll be with me forever. God said, I'm not casting the man's face. I'm casting his heart.
Wow.
And then I just knew, this is the man.
Yeah.
You know, isn't that? But he has the face. But you know what I mean?
You're 6 feet under already, brother.
Oh, guys, behave.
It's too late now.
Excuse them. They are pretty excitable.
Wait until you're about to tell about the other things.
I think it's time for a shootout.
Okay, I'm not getting involved. Here they go.
Down at the OK Corral.
Here they go. Here they go. Here they go.
You got me.
Do you feel good now?
Oh,
I'm glad.
Much better.
No,
much
I'm glad. Do you think it's imperative to cast Christians to play in this visual Bible?
I can say that it's okay, but there are a few characters that you cannot. And for instance, Jesus, I had to get somebody that was spirit-filled, child of God, knew about the new creation, because he wouldn't have been able to do it otherwise. You know, I don't think it's the Lord told me that he would give me a Christian. So but I knew that. And now we did Acts of the Apostles, and you cannot play Paul if you don't understand the new birth. You know, if you don't understand what being born again is all about, you don't understand the power of God, you don't understand the working of the Holy Spirit, you cannot play the part. It is impossible.
As he neared Damascus on his journey, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice say to him,
Saul, Saul. Why do you persecute me?
Who are you, Lord?
Saul asked.
I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting.
He replied.
Now get up and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do.
Whenever, you know, any of us, when we're involved in doing things for the Lord, you know, whether it's a television show or a movie or writing a book or even in ministry, you know, the key, the bottom line, is just do what God tells you to do.
Period.
You know, if he tells you to cast a believer, you cast a believer.
That's the truth.
You know, that's the bottom line,
if
I think.
If he allows you to cast an unbeliever in, who doesn't understand it, but he's a really good actor, the Lord will work. He'll work through the guy. God anointed a donkey to talk, you know, so he can make an unbeliever act.
Before very long, a wind of hurricane force called a northeaster swept down from the island. The ship was caught by the storm and could not head into the wind, so we gave way to it and were driven along. As we passed to the lee of a small island called Cauda, we were hardly able to make the lifeboat secure. When the men had hoisted it aboard, they passed ropes under the ship itself to hold it together. Fearing that they would run aground on the sandbars of Syrtis, they lowered the sea anchor and let the ship be driven along. We took such a violent battering from the storm that the next day they began to throw the cargo overboard. On the third day, they threw the ship's tackle overboard with their own hands. When neither sun nor stars appeared for many days and the storm continued raging, we finally gave up all hope of being saved. After the men had gone a long time without food, Paul stood up before them and said,
"Men, you should have taken my advice not to sail from Crete. Then you would have spared yourselves this damage and loss. But now I urge you to keep up your courage, because not one of you will be lost."
On a final note, what would you like to tell our viewers out there, the guys who are into J&Co?
Oh, man.
J&Co. Mm-hmm. It starts with the J. That's it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know, Hebrews 12, and this is just the bottom line for me. It says, "Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame. Consider him." We're always considering ourselves, you know. Yeah. Oh, Lord, I need this, I need this. Consider him.
Yeah, focus on Jesus.
Yeah, who endured such opposition from sinful men. That's the bottom line of life.
Yeah.
Don't forget us next week.
We'd like your company.
Channel 1, 6 p.m. Sunday.
We'll see,
see you then.
Company! March!
Exactly.
Well, why don't you go and find out?
Find out?
Okay.
Yeah, let's go find out, Charl.
Yeah.
This is fire station, as in petrol station, where you get full of instead of put out by. The reason for it was when this vision came to me, I was on a little weekend away just by myself and talking to God. And the scripture that I got after this vision really gelled with me was Joshua 8:8, and it's a very powerful scripture. It says, "And when you have taken the city, then set it on fire." So this is what it's about. It's the place where the fire starts, and then it gets transferred all over the place. Well, the fire station is actually a culmination of a vision that started as an organization to network musicians and artists in the Durban area. And the idea is to create an infrastructure instead of the churches being independent and all the musicians and artists and people trying to do their own thing, but to create an infrastructure, something that works together corporately to become more effective in developing a youth culture, not only in Durban, but wherever that thought and that idea would lead us. But at the moment, to start in Durban and to develop a really strong youth culture, a place where young people can hang out, where the philosophy that's inherent in the place isn't destructive, in fact, it's very, very constructive.
And something really constructive is painting and creating wonderful works of art. Down at the fire station, we met some hot Christian artists.
As an artist who finds herself living life as a Christian, okay, with Jesus as my Lord, I invite him into every aspect of my life. And, you know, obviously I'm going to glorify him in whatever I'm doing, whether it's painting or whether it's working out at the gym or whether it's ordinary household tasks. What I'm trying to convey is a sense of a process, to take the viewer on a journey, and that's basically the idea of having four separate works. Okay, I've just chosen a simple mealie, which is a normal everyday object, and by choosing something mundane and ordinary and putting it into isolation, almost framing it in a wide space, it draws attention to that, and it invites the viewer to take a second look, to look further than what's just there. God is the creator of the universe. He's the master architect. He's the master creator. And in each of us, there's such an inherent ability to create and to do and to be. And I'd say just pick up that pencil, pick up that paintbrush and go for it. And just trust God as your Lord and see what happens. And He'll take you each step of the way. You know, you don't have to get involved in the secularization of the world as it sees art. You know, you can just trust God for your ideas and He'll give them to you. Go for it.
My work will be done in a Christian fashion. My work will communicate Christian ideas and my ideas, the ways I like to live my life. My Christian faith is inherent, it's part of me, and it will come out in whatever I do.
Some of you might recognize this poster. What you might not know is that it was based on an original painting. We meet the artist.
If you're true and you're in touch with what's inside of you and you're expressing it, I mean, it's going to come out. I don't try to be a Christian artist. In fact, I don't like to be known as a Christian artist. I don't think there is such a thing. I think if you are, you know, if you're in touch with who you are and just creating, it's going to come out. It's almost like a subconscious thing.
Now, our focus and our aim is to meet the needs of Christian young people. There's no place for them to socialize. And in doing that, it becomes immediately evangelical as well, because once the Christians are happy here and they feel that they wouldn't be embarrassed to bring their friends here, then that's what they're going to do. Also, the standard and the quality of club that we want to create is going to be so good that if somebody says to them, "Look, why don't you go to this sleazy club down the road?" they're going to say, "What on earth do I want to go there for? We can go to the fire station."
Great t-shirts there, guys. Now meet the guys who made them. This is Hayes and Ash, and they're from Celestial T-shirts. Okay. Now, guys, tell us how you came about this business, this t-shirt business.
So basically, you started with that dinosaur there. We call that's a dinosaur. Because we didn't have these t-shirts printed, and we wanted to get 1,500 t-shirts printed, which is 300 of each design.
Okay.
And we started with 14, and we finished with 5 after we had done a survey. Those ones there, we just had to make them out of polystyrene and stick them on those things, and all went around us to functions, to concerts, all sorts of stuff. And basically we got an order, and a person would put down 15 rand deposit, and we'd take the order, and that's how we got finance to get going. And then God just opened doors from then on, and we managed to get 1,500 printed.
Okay, excellent.
And that's our story.
Now, do you guys design these t-shirts yourselves, or do you use copyright, or No, are these your own designs?
Yeah, we design them ourselves.
And what inspires you to make these designs?
Oh, hopefully we say it's God, because each time we create a design or whatever, we base it on, each one of them are scriptural. They've got a scripture at the bottom of them. And we basically just feel like God inspired, and we've actually done more than what is here. Mm-hmm. But we've just felt that we have to pick 5 out of here.
Okay.
And just pump the best 5 designs we got at the moment for the spirit of the market.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, and where do you see your business going towards the future? Are you going to expand or...?
Basically, we're designers. Yeah. We can't help but be designers. So we're wanting to reach people through advertising. Yeah. T-shirts is a wonderful medium for advertising. Okay. I mean, billboards, all sorts of stuff. Maybe even television, and who knows what happens.
It's a living advert for Jesus Christ.
That's right.
Without happening now.
Now, these are only items, you only make t-shirts, so you're going to be making other things as well?
Definitely.
Okay.
I mean, caps.
For example?
Caps, maybe even in a winter range, track suits, all sorts of stuff.
Baggies, yeah. We want to even go into a Christian surf range, and when I hit, there's a gap in the youth that's been left by the world. That's all the music t-shirts, all the surf t-shirts have all gotten very satanic, and we just want to pump the gospel.
We can have people holding workshops, drama, dance. We can have the art gallery as an ongoing thing with new work coming through all the time. All the different aspects. We want to have a fully set up rehearsal room so bands can come here to practice. We want to have the facility when guys are sitting having a cup of coffee over here that they meet somebody they wouldn't normally meet in their social circle, and they disappear into a practice room and something creative comes out of there. So very much kind of like a laboratory aspect as well. I think it's very important at the moment, at this stage of developing a new nation, to develop our own culture too. For too long we've just had secondhand American or British culture sort of dished out to us, and this is what we cling to because we have no other. But we have such a rich diversity in ourselves, but we need a vehicle for that to come together and then an infrastructure for it to become effective.
Well guys, we got to see amazing art.
And we got to try on some fantastic t-shirts.
But what do young people think?
Do they think?
I don't know.
What do they think about the fire station?
I think we should try and find out.
Good thinking. We want to find out, what do you think about the fire station?
It's the best.
It's amazing. It's absolutely amazing.
I think it's excellent. It's one of the few opportunities that Christians get to really enjoy themselves.
I think it's a great place with great music, and it's good, keen Christian fun. And if you're really looking for a great place to hang out at, I really recommend this place.
It's humming. It's really good. It's fun.
Why do you think it's such an amazing place?
Because it's just what the youth of Durban needs, and it's such a nice place to just relax.
It's an opportunity for us to get out there and be Christians, because there's so much out there for worldly kids, but there's nothing for us. And it's an alternative where we can really come and be together with our Christian friends.
I like the pipeline and the new shops. It's great. The art galleries, it's great. The music.
As long as we're all here to have fun, not to do anything else, totally excellent. Jesus is Lord. As long as he's number one, who can go wrong here?
Young people need to socialize. They need a place to go, and they're getting ripped off in the world, and they're getting beaten up, and they're getting their lives ruined. And as the church corporately coming together, no matter what denomination or what background, the church united to create a venue like this for the young people, that's what it's about.
We've got something. A venue like this wouldn't be hard without great live music.
And let's go find out who's in the house.
Hey guys, it sounds like you.
Oh,
my rock. You are the reason I will not stop. You are my joy and you are my peace. Your love and mercy will never cease. You are my reason, you are the light. Sin is the enemy and I will fight to keep my heart strong and true. But when I'm down, I know what to do.
There. J&Co is in the house.
Well, actually, we're out and about this week.
Well, actually, they got to meet one of the best contemporary Christian musicians of all time.
And you were busy.
Well, during his Thanksgiving tour last year,
Scott Wesley Brown hung out with us.
Scott Wesley Brown is a well-known singer, songwriter, and musician, and he has performed in more than 30 countries. Scott, his wife Belinda, and his daughters Hannah and Jessica spent some time chilling out with the gang from J&Co.
That was good! Oh. I love it! Scott, how was it?
Seems like your ministry is really rolling, eh? Nope.
All right. Well, at least we're on the right track.
Okay. Is it like on the right track of your ministry? Yeah. All right. We're getting on the go.
Talk about rolling and right track. How long have you been here before, Scott?
Yeah, this is my fifth time to South Africa.
Fifth time?
Right.
All right.
Been to Africa 10 times. Been here 5 times.
You just want the Lord to bring you here, though?
Oh, well, I want the Lord to bring me here now.
Okay.
I used to be afraid of Africa because I heard you all had big bugs.
Okay.
I heard the bugs are so big they have lips.
Now tell me, Scott, with your ministry, you concentrated a lot on praise and worship music. Are you going to stay in that genre, or are you planning to maybe elaborate more on your music?
Well, I think I'll always do artist albums, but I really think that praise and worship music is a real important part
of my ministry, and I really like leading worship. I'm the worship director of my church.
Okay, okay, where is that about?
It's right outside of Nashville, Tennessee.
All right, so it's in the middle of the whole recording.
Right. We've got a lot of Christian artists in our church, and a lot of them help us out on the worship teams. And,
all right.
And, it's really neat. God is doing a neat thing among Christian artists in America, and yeah, worship fantastic. Is real important.
Now, I want to go more into your personality, and that is, if you were to become anything except a musician and a gospel singer, tell us, what would you be? What would you like to be? Maybe a cowboy or a doctor, or what would you want to become?
Well, I probably, if I wasn't doing Christian music, I still would be in the church. I think I would want to be a pastor of a church. I really enjoy theology and studying the Word, and I probably would be doing something along that line. Maybe a youth leader or something like that.
Okay. Now, tell us, how many albums have you already now got out there? How many albums?
I think it's a total of 18.
On that same score, Charl, do you have one currently now?
Well, I've got actually two new albums have come out this year. Sparrow Records released a 30-song collection of a lot of my songs throughout the years. And then also I have a worship album that just came out on Hosanna Integrity Music.
And is it here in the continent?
It just has been released.
Oh, that's fantastic. Now, I don't know if you're familiar with the situations in our country. Now, if there's a message that you want to convey through your concerts, what would the message be at your concerts?
Well, I think that, you know, God has really blessed South Africa. I mean, just the abundance here is incredible, and I really think that God has strategically done this in South Africa so that South Africa can impact the rest of Africa and the whole world.
Yeah. Now, you said that you sometimes, a lot of the younger artists in America, you give them advice. Now, what type of advice do you give young artists in the United States that want to become gospel singers? What type of advice do you give them?
Well, I think the number one thing is to have a good, strong relationship with their church, to be accountable. Because, I mean, a lot of Christian artists have made some pretty bad mistakes recently, and there's been a lot of problems in Christian music. And I really think that artists need to stay close to their church. They need to be not controlled by the church, but they need to be accountable to the church.
I see.
And the church can also act as a real source of encouragement. Yeah. You know, they can pray for them. I mean, right now my church knows where I'm at.
All right, yeah.
And on that same score, how long have you been a gospel and a Christian musician? Because I can like look back as far back as 90s, even further down. You've been a Christian musician for how long now?
Well, I've been in Christian music since 1973.
Did you say 70? I'm looking at the 90s, talking 70s. Wow!
Yeah, I started Christian music back in the days when it was a part of the Jesus movement. It was coming out of the Jesus movement, and a lot of old groups like Love Song and Mustard Seed Faith, groups that you don't hear about anymore, Second Chapter of Acts, Keith Green, you might have heard of Keith Green.
Yeah. Oh yeah, that's good music.
Chuck Gerard and Love Song. And
what has helped you to stay focused? I mean, you know, you've been consistent till this far.
Well, I love ministry through Christian music. I don't think I could ever stop singing. And I know I can't quit writing songs because God just keeps giving me songs, and as long as He keeps giving me songs,
okay.
You know, it's always good to have an audience to sing them to. And, and so I think I'll keep on as long as the Lord will let me.
And while Scott was here, we got to make a video with him, especially for Jay and Company.
And she was so quiet in that interview.
But once again, we go back in time with Charl.
This time to encounter another Jay. The Baptist, John.
Cross section.
Sorry. Can I perhaps help you?
I am the voice in the wilderness. Make straight the ways of the Lord.
Excuse me, I can't hear you. Come a little closer. We have a chat over here.
Sorry, that whole wilderness thing is what Isaiah used to say about me.
Isaiah? But who are you?
The Baptist.
Sorry, I've already been baptized, thank you.
No, John.
John the Baptist?
Hey, pleased to meet you. Charl, good.
Good, yes.
No, that's my surname, Coud. Pleased to meet you.
Good, yeah.
No, that's my surname, Coud. My father gave it to me when
whatever.
I was...
Whatever. Yeah. Anyway. I didn't mean to startle you, you know. I used to run this whole wilderness thing to keep the Pharisees on their toes. You know, they were a bunch of law-pushing twits. I mean, they wanted to know who I was. And I wanted them to know who Jesus was.
Yes, but wasn't your message one of... repentance?
Repent! For the kingdom of the Lord is nigh.
Yes, just next time don't shout it so loud.
Okay. Sorry, it's just that I used to love doing it. Repent! Yes. Repentance, you were saying?
Yes, it's just that you were known as quite an amazing man. You weren't scared to confront people. I recall a passage in... Matthew 3, verse 7, when you called the Pharisees a brood of vipers?
Yes, I remember that, yeah.
I mean, these are church-going people. And Herod, you told him to repent of his sin. I mean, you were taking words of truth and people were moved to repentance. But yet, those same words moved others to resist the truth. These people wanted to kill you. Don't you think that your words were a bit radical?
Radical? These people were so blinded by religion that they couldn't even see the truth, let alone hear it. So yes, maybe I was a bit radical. It's the only way to get my message through to them.
Well, do you think that's what makes you so uncompromising?
That... And I knew God had a plan for my life. You see, a very long time ago, Gaby came down to visit my father.
Gaby, not...
Gabriel.
Oh, Gabriel, the angel.
He came down and he told my father that I was going to be the one to prepare the way for the coming of the Lord. And as a child, growing up, I knew all along that once I'd submitted my will to God, he would take care of things. He did. He did. And besides which, if God is with us, who can be against us?
True.
Oh, big one. Gotta go.
Bon appetit, John. Well, there you go. John, quite an amazing fellow. But you know, he was a man of integrity. And I think that's what God is looking for in all of us, is integrity. Now, if you're content to do what God wants you to do, and you just give him all the glory, the honor, and the praises, I believe that you're going to see some pretty amazing things happening in your life. I wonder what those grasshoppers taste like. Bye-bye.
And now, for the first time,
brought to you on Jay and Company,
we give you Scott Wesley Brown in a video from his latest album, Mission of Praise.
This is the Gospel of Christ.
To destroy the works of the evil one and the kingdom of darkness with light, and to rescue men from the law of sin, this is the Gospel of Christ. The news unto the poor and the brokenhearted new life, and for those who mourn, heaven's child is born. This is the gospel of Christ. And to God be the glory, and to God be the glory, and to God be the glory. This is the gospel.
Hello and hey, it's great to see you again.
And a big howdy from J&Co.
And how are you doing this week?
How's it going?
What's up?
This week in J&Co, we move just a little bit faster.
We go dancing, ooh la la la.
And we have music.
Oh yes, and we meet the guys who make that music.
Most specifically, we go MIC.
And we talk techno.
And we make a revolution.
I'll sign up for the revolution, eh?
No, not like a French revolution. Not French, it's like revolution.
Revolution. I'm not supposed to know if you're saying revolution. I mean, revolution is revolution,
it's
sure.
Just a normal revolution. It's just right at your doorstep.
Noticed that all around the country, more and more young people are enjoying dance music. So just for you, the J&Co presenters perform this number from the album, Jumping in the House of God.
You are here.
here among us.
And you have anointed me.
Tell them now the good news. Setting all the prisoners free.
You have sent me on to find their hearts and make it clear. To proclaim the favor of the Lord throughout the year.
And
destroy your enemies.
Spreading joy and gladness. Going on eternally. You have sent me on to bind the hearts and make it clear.
To proclaim the favor of the Lord throughout the year. And I know, and I know. And I know you have anointed me, and I know you have a plan to set us free. And I know you have anointed me, and I know you have a plan to set us free. And I know.
If you enjoy hot praise and worship, you'll just have to enter our great competition. You can win one of these three great CDs. Jumping in the House of God, We Don't Get What We Deserve, Now That's What I Call Worship. Write to us at this address and tell us which CD you'd like to win. J&Co, PO Box 91244, Auckland Park 2006. And here are those titles again.
Last year, Charl and the J&Co dancers started a revolution.
No, actually, Jesus started the revolution. Audio Adrenaline wrote the song and they danced.
Bang, bang! Bang. Bang. It's a revolution.
Grab a sword.
solution. A bang bang, it's a revolution. A bang bang, it's a revolution.
Oh well, if you really want some more, you can get the real thing live. Yes, some of the hottest music in the country will be happening near you. Durban techno trio MIC will be doing a national mega rave tour, this time joined by a new dynamic team of dancers. On the 13th, they will be doing their thing at Quigney Baptist in East London. And you better get down to Grahamstown to see them at Victoria Girls High School on the 15th. The Civic Centre in George is the place to be on the 16th. And on the 23rd, MIC will be joining lots of other hot local bands at the JC Rocks Festival at the Lighthouse in Cape Town. MIC are renowned for their brilliant live performances, as well as their dynamic sound and their fantastic computer-driven intelligent lighting system. A show you just have to see. Wow, somebody stop me.
How are you all doing?
Hey, what's happening?
This week, Kingdom gets to make things happen.
Yep, he's been keeping some straight company.
Hi there, thank you for keeping company with us right here at J&Co. We are in this incredibly beautiful place, the mother city, Cape Town. But anyway, I wish you were here. Well, do allow me though to introduce to you, all the way from the US of A, Straight Company. Hi guys.
Hey,
how are you?
How do we do?
We're doing great.
Yeah, absolutely. Now guys, you know, you are here in the country. Let's talk about, where did it all start for you?
Started in Louisville, Kentucky. Mm-hmm. It's in the USA.
Yeah.
That's where most of us are from.
Oh yeah.
We have one guy from Alabama. Chris is from Alabama.
Is this Chris?
Chris is Chris, yeah.
Is this Chris?
At beautiful okay. State Alabama. Yeah. Down south.
Enough promotion, thank you very much.
And Mark is from Michigan.
Mark? Michigan? State of Michigan.
State of it's cold right there.
Oh,
and this is T.
Hi, T.
How you doing?
And I'm E. Sage, and this is Yvette.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it started in Louisville.
Oh, yeah.
And these are not the original Faces Kingdom.
Okay.
This is the new Straight Company. We've kept the same sound, though. And the sound has been very pleasant to our audiences. God has blessed us, and we've moved around the world. We're finally glad to be in South Africa, our first time here.
Absolutely. Now, talk about the sound, taking your cue from there. Chris, talk to me. It could have been techno rave. It could have been jazz. It could have been anything else. Why a cappella?
A cappella. Beautiful, 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 beautiful question, and it deserves a beautiful answer.
Here we go.
We were all raised up basically in the churches of Christ, and that's where we learned our method of singing.
Mm-hmm.
We sang harmony with the voices, and you can't touch anything that can beat what God gave you originally.
Absolutely.
Because when the power goes off, what you got?
The voices.
Huh?
You've got the voices.
When you're standing on the corner and you're bebopping, what you got?
You've got the voices.
Man, you got each other.
Absolutely.
And you got your voices. Mm-hmm. And you work well together. And congregationally, we believe that in worship, you know, it was not scripturally authorized. So, and that even gave us a religious aura that pushed us even further. Yeah. So that's why, you know.
Now, are we saying that we're not changing the style of music in the future? We're going to stick with the a cappella throughout?
We are forever known as an a cappella group because for 20 years, that's what we've done.
For 20 years.
We are branching out a little bit, mm-hmm. and we're doing some additional things, but we're basically known as an a cappella group. Our next album, which is coming out a little bit later in February,
mm-hmm.
Next month, as a matter of fact, it features some instrumental tracks along with some a cappella songs. So we're branching out a little bit, but we're true to the form of a cappella music.
Now let's talk about a cappella style of music and just taking a cue from there as well. I think that certain types of music have certain audiences.
Yeah.
Do you think that a cappella has a good audience capacity?
I do. And we're finding...
And is this on a global scale?
On a global scale, where we've traveled out of the country of the USA, it has been very well accepted. Because the places that we've gone have really appreciated the uniqueness of it,
mm-hmm.
and how clear it is. And then we keep a real bouncy, fun groove to it. So we kind of make it exciting. So we like for our audience to receive it just like that.
Yeah.
Easy to move about.
Yeah.
No instruments.
Yeah. We take up the whole stage.
Yeah. Way to go. Well, now, guys, I think that will suffice for now. What's happening? Way of closing? Are you considering to come back again?
Yeah.
Yeah. When is this?
Well, I'm not exactly sure, but I think
February. February. 97.
Okay. That is what? Couple of 12 months or so?
A little bit more than a year. They're going to take a year to do some promotion.
Yeah.
And we're going to talk to some radio. We're glad to talk to you and
and
your program, Jay and Company.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it's been fun.
Well, guys, you know, this talk about company, this is Straight Company, this is Jay and Company.
Yeah.
The company's in the house now.
Later on in the program, Straight Company sings just for us.
But before they do that, let us remind you about our great competition.
You can win one of the three hot CDs, and they are...
Hosanna. Jumping in the House of God.
Hosanna. Hosanna.
We may allow ourselves a brief period of rejoicing.
We don't get what we deserve.
This is the original celebration. Come catch this. Come on.
Now, that's what I call worship.
All right.
Just tell us which CD you'd like to win.
And our address.
P.O. Box 91244, Auckland Park 2006.
And now,
Cross Section.
Cross Section.
Ooh, you must be Samson.
And you,
Must be Nicole.
That's right. Samson, it's so nice of you to keep me, I mean, us, company.
Pleasure's all mine.
Samson, I've always wanted to ask you this question. Did you really push that building down? You must be really, strong.
Yes, I did. And, yes, I am.
No, but I mean, super strong.
On the outside, yes, but on the inside, it's a different story.
So tell us that story then.
Well, basically, I was born to do great things, and I was going to be one of the leaders that was going to set the Israelites free from the Philistines.
Wow. So what happened?
Well, as a boy, I grew up and everything was fine. But like all men, I started looking at the ladies. It was like my mother always said to me. She said, Samson, love is not a feeling. It's an act of will. But then I met, you know who?
The lady that changed your life, right?
Oh, Delilah, Delilah, Delilah. After I met her, everything went wrong. I lost my strength, my anointing, and I stepped out of God's perfect plan for me.
So you actually could have achieved more than just pushing down buildings, right?
Yeah, I guess so. My outer strength was dynamic, but my inner strength was disappointing.
Well, what do you mean by inner strength?
Well, the real strength of a man is not how physically strong he is, but how strong he is inside.
As a man thinks, so is he.
Yes. And I used to do a lot of thinking. About all the wrong things. So what are you thinking about, Nicole?
I think I should go and have a chat with God and ask him what he wants to do with my life. J&Co, go, yeah!
And now some super sounds from Straight Company.
This video was done just for us on J&Co.
And please take note of the extravagant smoke effects on Table Mountain.
Not.
Well, watch the video.
And we'll see you next week.
SAPC 1.
6 p.m.
On Sunday.
What the world needs now.
devotion. I know we need to have a little love.
Hi guys.
Surf's up.
And we went down.
In Cape Town.
The occasion?
The Jesus Summer Festival.
The location?
Blouberg Strand.
Wow, let's go.
Let's go.
I got something for you, man.
You may wonder exactly what went on at the Jesus Summer Festival.
Well, it was summer and we celebrated Jesus with the Sun Surf Club. This is how.
The Jesus Summer Festival began about October last year. There's a youth fraternal which meets in Blouberg. All the youth groups get together. And we were getting together for a couple of months and then we said, well, let's do something, you know. And we had planned the Zero Sun Surf Series to carry on this year. But we thought of making it a little bit bigger, so each one of the youth groups pitched in and each one was responsible for a big part of the festival. A contact point, because most of the guys that surf the competitions are probably not Christians, and it's a great outreach opportunity, you know, just to be what Jesus wants us to be, and laugh and exciting and doing, reaching the guys where they're at, you know. Faith and experience. Oh, no. The first year we've done it, I'm definitely planning to keep it a national event, but I think the public really enjoy it. It's a great thing to do, there's lots of activities. The rollerblading is really exciting to watch, the volleyball, touch rugby, you know, gives a good vibe at the beach, you know, something's happening, going on, there's music and great sunny weather.
Alright Dimitri, you're also one of the Jesus Freaks we now met here at the Summer Festival, because I see on your board you got your stoke, Jesus Freak. Yeah. Now, why did you put this on your board?
Well, just generally people like have this perception of Christians have been like real church people, conservative types and guys who are not into fun, and like Stoke Jesus Freak is like just about like how I am and a lot of the guys in the club, you know, we're really just stoked on Jesus, and he's the one who's given us life and fullness, and we're stoked on that.
We have a meeting at the Big Bay Lifesaving Club every Monday night, which is a good thing. It's a good way to spread the word and encourage the youngsters to get off the streets, get off the drugs, and become a part of a good vibe.
All right, but now you're talking about spreading the word.
Yeah.
How exactly do you implement your ministry?
Oh, well, being surfers, young surfers, they're into, it's a big image thing in a way, and they think it's, quite a hardcore image, but it's nice for them to know that you don't have to go out and party and get drunk every night. You can come and have some good time and fellowship, with fellow Christian surfers.
How does the surfing affect the ministry?
We surf for God. This is what it is. We don't surf to go out and be good or anything. We surf to have fun and to something we do for God.
Yeah, I don't image or anything like cool and watch our wave. And we just have fun.
We had a goal at the beginning of last year just to open lots of clubs like this, and it's been so amazing because it hasn't been as a result of myself or Roy. It's just been like guys that have pulled us up, some have found out about us, and they said, they'd really dig to go with that, and they've opened up clubs, and now we're sitting with 9 clubs around the country,
Right.
And it's just blows my mind, yeah.
And now for some completely different action.
This time on land.
And in the air.
The famous surprise, but
absolutely.
I put everything into it, so. And we work as a team.
That's right. The basic thing is working as a team. Mm-hmm. Getting to understand each other, and then you just take it from there.
Enjoy it.
What's a spiritual phenomenon or significance about this game or your winning today? Anything you'd like to say?
Yeah, I actually just want to encourage the guys out there, We as Christians, we don't have to sit around. We can get out and we can go make a difference out there. Who said we don't have to go for Western Province in South Africa?
Hello,
Hello, yeah.
All the glory that for today must just go to God, because nothing that I organized here could have been out of my own strength. And I want to encourage you guys to keep on serving God.
Amen. Thank you very much. Well, this is the man who was behind the volleyball thing. If ever you need to do volleyball next time, guess who you must speak to? Wagner. Yes, sir. Thank you very much.
The most important part of the festival was to change people's lives.
And so the Sun Surfers aim to meet people where they're at.
Even if they are on wheels.
And in the air.
Your attitudes, okay, towards each other when you're on the course and off the course. How does that differ? I mean, there has obviously got to be the competitive attitude towards, both of you towards each other on the actual course net. Are you guys friends off the course net, or is there a bit of rivalry sometimes off the course as well?
Yeah, we had a bit of rivalry game before.
But on the course, it's definitely like aggressive towards each other. I mean, you're out there to beat the guy, and when we're skating like local, then it's, friends.
I am glad I'm a victim of love.
Alright, I've been watching these guys for a while now, and rollerblading isn't that difficult, so I'm going to try a few jumps, so watch me.
And so, with great anticipation, we awaited Brandon's grand feat.
This time I've never done this before, please.
There he goes. He's doing fine. Alrighty then, let's try again.
Second attempt, looking good. Oopsie!
Maybe we should help. Almost there. Not bad, I suppose. After all the fun in the sun, these dedicated young people got real with Jesus.
Dip your heart in the streams of life. Let the pain and the sorrow be washed away in the waves of His mercy. As deep cries out to Thee, and we sing. Dip your heart in the streams of life. Dip your heart in the streams of life. Let the pain and the sorrow be washed away. Be washed away in the waves of His mercy. His deep cries out. With all your heart tonight, sing to Jesus Christ tonight. Come, Lord Jesus. For too long, the devil's been walking around out there with all his drug abuse, all the stuff that we see in the raves, all the stuff that we see in every different culture. And I want you to know that tonight, we're going to put a stop to that in Tableview, because Jesus Christ is going to be King of Tableview tonight. Your heart be also. Your heart stays where you hide your greatest love. Now you can leave that love on earth, where thieves may steal tomorrow, or take it to that hiding place above. Now there's a treasure at the end of this narrow road I'm traveling, and it gives me a purpose for life. Jesus is my treasure, the only reason that I live, and He'll still be the reason.
So, if any of you want to have some fun in the sun, with the sun, call Cape Town 230531 and get moving with Jesus.
And talking about moving,
Club Life will host an original righteous rave over the Easter weekend
at the Peace Cafe on the 5th of April at 9:30 p.m.
And the 6th at 8 p.m. they start happening.
Cape Town's official resurrection rave.
With the best in sanctified dance music. And don't forget to catch the best of the bands at the Jesus Summer Festival on J&Co, 21st of April.
We'll see you again on the 7th, when we'll celebrate something big. Come and join us! Woohoo! And a big thank you to the man who filmed it all.
Go, Wimpie, go!